Hello everybody, I'm very glad to present you my presentation to the topic the reception of Atlantis in current children's media as unnatural island. I want to show you the following points. My thesis is that the reception of Atlantis in current children's media is an unnatural island. And at first, I want to demonstrate why Atlantis is so popular in current children's media. Then, I want to show you the Platon's version of Atlantis. And after that, there will be some prominent examples to show the existence of Platon's Atlantis, for example, in the novel Weltensuche, which means in English, Searching for Worlds, Asterix, Ice Age Part 4, Disney's Atlantis, and Aquaman. At least I will come to the conclusion that current trends of adapting the myths of Atlantis to current children's media. Now let's start with some words of Brentius. He said that Atlantis has never been so popular like in the last few years, and he considers that Atlantis swims on the waves of pulp fiction literature. It is adapted in about 20,000 or 30,000 volumes, and this by the year 1993, and it also emerges in a lot of movies. And this is a very pessimistic view on the current reception of Atlantis. On the other hand, Atlantis is a prototype for fantasy literature, and especially Plato's version. This is what Rüppel says. According to her, besides, she focuses on the cartography of the Lord of the Rings. Atlantis is a fantastic and wild island, and is considered as an archetype of Greco-Roman mythology. On the third position, Pitcher says that Atlantis is not only in movies and in novels very popular, but it is also very, very popular in comics. He says for much of this period, allusions to classical Greece and Rome stressed the numinous, exotic, mysterious. Such an ambience was the preserve of entirely fictional cultures such as Atlantis. He also considers that the myths of Atlantis is a motive for an exotic, mystic, and natural island. So in my paper, I want to demonstrate that Atlantis is ambiguous, demonstrated, it is presented as an utopian, exotic, and wild setting on of another world. On the other hand, on the on the one hand, and on the other hand, it's a very unnatural wildlife which is discovered by a hero who gets in contact with this, as you can see on the right picture. It's a little bit like in steampunk fantasy literature. In Plato's version of Atlantis, you can see, according to Müller, who analyzed the version in Plato's dialogues, the ancient island of Atlantis was inhabited by the descendants of Poseidon, whom he had fathered with the mortal woman Cleito. In the middle of the island, the temple of Poseidon is situated. It is surrounded by five rings of water, which serve as seaways for ships. When you look into the standard version, also in the prominent lexicographical version of Trip, you can find the following aspects as fundamental structural elements of the myth. The legendary island is situated on the other side of the columns of Hercules in the Atlantic Ocean. The god Poseidon guards the security of the island. The descendants of Poseidon and Cleito inhabit the island. The temple of Poseidon in the middle is surrounded by several rings of water for shipping and protection. And on the fifth point, the people of Atlantis wage war in order to extend their territory. And on the last point, the island is destroyed by an earthquake and a terrible flood. Now let's take a look in which way these points are adapted in current children's media. So now at first we will take a close look on Thomas Thiemeyer, the chronics of the searchers for worlds. The Temple of Poseidon is the second part of this series, and in this book the researcher Carl Friedrich of Humboldt, which is very famous, he's on a dangerous expedition with his crew and detects the sunken island of Atlantis. He is searching for sunken ships, and he wants to find out why those ships have disappeared. Humboldt starts with his ship, the submarine Calypso, in which he navigates his crew around the sea, and soon they are captured by a mechanic Cyclops and taken to the bottom of the sea, where they find the sunken island of Atlantis. Then they discover the island, and is here designed as a very unnatural and cyberpunk version of Atlantis, and it is explained that some time ago the crazy researcher Livanus has discovered the destroyed and sunken island of Atlantis with his machine named Darren, and it has an artificial intelligence because it's a difference engine working with algorithmic codes. And in this way he renovated the island and the ruins of the sunken island, and he built a robotic town with Cyclops to hook ships with the energy of a mystic crystal. And Livanos called it Mediterranea. It's the name of the new version of Atlantis, and he wants to create a topic Society Without Violence and Gore, and for that he wants to create humans who are mixed with technology so that cyborgs are created. When we compare both versions, the god of Poseidon is replaced by an intelligent algorithm here, because it's a profane version, and the underwater empire is ruled by a godless researcher who plays God himself. The island is situated at the Aegean Sea near the archipelagos of Santorin, and this is a hypothesis of the popular researcher like Marinatos. Furthermore, the setting of Atlantis is a profane and very unnatural one in which the society of robots is being created, and the power of the sunken island is a magic crystal as a fairy tale motif, and the artificial intelligence of Darren. So the allocation significantly differs from Plato's version. It is modernized and turned into a dystopic place. Very different to this is the version in Asterix and Obelix All Sea. The protagonist Obelix is transformed into a child, and the druid Miraculix, he wants to sail to Atlantis to make Obelix an adult again, and this he wants to manage with the help of Spartacus. This is an allusion to Spartacus, the Roman movie from the 60s with Kurt Russell as Spartacus, as you can see on the picture. When they discover the island, you can see a very nice and natural flora and fauna. It is very lavish and wild, and Atlantis is transformed into a locus amenus here with a lot of children and also with musical beasts like the dolphins you can see there, and they are an adaptation maybe of the dolphins of the palace of dolphins on Crete, as you can see on the picture on the right side. Also, the columns are adapted from the Crete temple of Minos, where the Minotaurus was was caught, as you can see on the picture. And here there are also some difference, because you can see no ruins but a complete palace, and it's also very idyllic with cypresses. There are also mystic swans and dolphins as vehicles and young centaurs. The interesting thing about Atlantis is here that it is a hybrid form between the land of milk and honey, as you see on the right picture of Bruegel's famous painting, and on the other hand it's kind of a Neverland, the island which emerges on Paris, Peter Pan. And this is a consideration of Volker Müller, who constated this. As you can see on the left picture, Obelix doesn't feel very comfortable here, despite of the very big fruits, because he misses some flying wild boars. Maybe he wants to eat some meat. And Asterix Atlantis serves as an ancient predecessor of Peter Pan's utopian island Neverland. The whole island is surrounded by wildlife and idyllic nature, which constitute an utopian locus amenus. In this version of the myth of Atlantis, only the aspects of the advanced culture of the island and the destructive force of the flood are mentioned. Let's move to another adaptation, and in this adaptation, Atlantis is also presented in a very idyllic and natural way. So, in the movie Ice Age 4, there's a protagonist which searches for big nuts, and everybody knows which animal is meant. It is Scrat, and in this part of the movie he searches for Scratlantis and finds an extraterrestrial Atlantis like an Olympian home, and when he finds it, the music is also very interesting, because the maker of the film, they play the Ninth Symphony of Beethoven, which is called in German Freude schöne Götterfunke. As you see on the pictures, here Scrat finds a treasure card, and on the bottom there is the island of Atlantis shown with a lot of golden light. Then he reaches the island and he meets a squirrel wearing a Greek toga, which kindly welcomes him and shows him the idyllic and natural setting, and it says, "Welcome, brother, behold, Scratlantis." When Scrat swims to the bay of the island, he passes cliffs and trees and green and wildlife vegetation, because of the island of Atlantis is shown as an utopian idyll like the one in Asterix. It is constructed like that because it is the home of godlike habitants. the setting is here, besides nature, a stoa poikile, where walking philosophers talk to each other. The squirrels are shown as an advanced society because they do astronomic research and dedicate themselves to other artes liberales, as playing the harp, dancing, or making very realistic sculptures, as the squirrel version of Rodas, the thinker. To stress funny moments, two squirrels' moments are shown while taking a bath of nuts. Scrat is very greedy, and he wants to get an enormous acorn from the middle of the island. And then the herald squirrel from the beginning says to him, "No, brother, stop, rise above this bay. This bay's desire be more than a rodent." But when we think about this, and everybody who knows the movie knows that Scrat is too weak, and he pulls the big nut out from the middle of the island, and The consequence is that a big whirl emerges and sets the sinking island underwater. Then the island immediately disappears, and maybe the island is here shown as a mirage because it vanishes as fast as it has been detected, like a wishful dream. Because Gret was on his own searching for the island without food, without drinking for many days. And this is the reason why Atlantis might have been an invention in his head. So the conclusion is that in this version just a few elements of Plato's myths are transported. Atlantis is a mythic island with an advanced civilization, which sinks because of hubris. This quality is demonstrated in this film by a foreigner and not by Atlantean people who are shown as godlike inhabitants of the island. Let's move to Disney's Atlantis. And in this adaptation, the island is presented as a very natural location, mixed with the culture of Indian people, and this is what I want to show you. When you take a look at the featurette of the DVD version, there is a point which names creating the myths and the inventions of the movie, and the creators, they say that they read Plato's version to create a very authentic island, as you can see on the pictures. this is Atlantis rising from the bottom, after being rescued by the protagonist, whose name is Milo. He's a young and futile philologist at the University of Washington, D.C., and he's able to decipher old letters. After passing the threshold, he investigates not only the old letters of the Atlantean civilization, but also the magical heart of Atlantis, and he wants to prevent this object from being stolen by Rurik, the bad leader of the group of researcher. In this version, Atlantis is presented as an ancient city with ruins like the ones of the Inca, as you can see it on Machu Picchu. And this you can see here. The setting is designed very naturally, and the flora and fauna are not damaged by the hyper-technical civilization. The citizens of Atlantis also dress like Aztecs and wear indigenous clothes with feathers, masks, and amulets, as you can see on this picture. the masks are also magical ones which can rise from the bottom and fly through the air with the magic power of the crystal. So in this adaptation, Atlantis as a natural reserve is threatened by by the American investigators. All in front, Rurik, the general who is insinuated like a general of the Nazis. Also, it is shown that the native people are very bad treated, like Christian conquerors treated the native civilization in the 15th century following the path of Columbus or Magellan. At last, I will show you that also in Aquaman there is on the one hand a very idyllic Atlantis designed, and on the other hand it is a very technical Atlantis. So it's here in the movie before the destruction of Atlantis, it is a high-end Atlantis had a high-end civilization. They have developed an advanced culture, and in the middle of the city there was a big temple surrounded by statues with tridents. Also, flying vehicles are used as means of transport. Here you can see the king of Atlantis to rule over a big civilization, and on the other pictures here it's also interesting. You see flying vehicles and machines which work with the power of steam engines, like in steampunk, but their usage is unclear. They are just some special effects. After the king has misused his superpower, the kingdom sank and the Atlanteans had to prove their power underwater. It is not explained why they suddenly were transformed into mermaids and mermen after sinking. As you can see on this picture, they are a hybrid between man and fish, but this fast evolution unfortunately is not explained in the film. And on this picture you can see the Atlantis sinking by a big flood. The story is told that Mera, the daughter of Nereus, has visited Arthur, the protagonist and son of Atlanna, the queen of Atlantis, and she wants him to visit Atlantis with a vehicle which is a robotic fish, and this is similar to the Disney version, in which also robotic fishes are used as vehicles. Besides the impressive lightning technique, Atlantis is shown as a secret city situated in a reef with a lot of living fishes such as whales and dolphins. The diversity of the sea is protected by the Atlanteans, and that is the reason why the Atlanteans prepare to fight against humankind, because the flora of fauna of the sea is threatened by humankind, because they pollute the sea with plastic and other rubbish. Also, the sunken city is high advanced, and the Atlanteans live in peace with mystical nature existing on the bottom of the sea. There the recipient is able to see the ruins of the former Atlantis overgrown by seagrass. The buildings, like the magnificent temple, maybe of Poseidon, in the middle, and the other buildings differ from Plato's version not very much. Atlantis is here a symbol for a reservation of nature in the middle of the sea, and it looks like a big and very robotic reef. As conclusions, you can say that the utopian version of Atlantis is like a mirage or a wishful dream of the protagonist, situated in an idyllic nature and natural environment, like a locus amenus. People and nature, flora and fauna live together in harmony, following the Stoic proverb secundum naturam vivere in the fifth epistle Morales by Seneca. Therefore, in popular culture, it is designed like a metaphor of a peaceful world in a mystical Nature, like it is shown in Disney's Atlantis and Aquaman, or as a metaphor of the land of milk and honey, also situated in a mythical nature, like in Ice Age or Asterix. In this way, you can find a connection to the fairy tale cocaine or the biblical Garden of Eden mixed with the beloved land of Canaan. In Asterix, there's also an intertextual allusion to Neverland of Very speed upon as a dystopia. Atlantis is designed as a tyranny of digital madness, far from nature, in which every human being must be uniform and hybridized with robots. The ambiguous character of Plato's Atlantis is retained in the adaptions. On the one hand, the utopian Atlantis rises from the ground and transforms the world a little big into a natural, peaceful place of freedom. Again, on the other hand, the dystopian Atlantis tries to conquer mankind and transform all human beings into soulless machines for the sake of economy. In adaptations of the myth of Atlantis, the topos of saving the environment from collapsing is very prominent. So maybe Greta Thunberg is an Atlantean girl. So at least there is Brentius, Atlantis researcher, who says because of the popularity of the island of Atlantis, it cannot sink anymore. And this is why we can read about this island forever and ever, I think. Thank you very much for your attention and goodbye. I hope you have enjoyed this short paper. And if you are more interested, you can also take a closer look on my primary and secondary sources. Goodbye.